17 things people aren't telling you about Tulum, possibly more than that, coming up. And if you're new here, welcome. I'm Christine with Where in the World is CL, and I make travel videos every week to help you get up, get out, and go travel. So if you like to travel, consider subscribing. I've spent the last 2 weeks in Tulum, and I absolutely love it so much that I canceled my flight back to the US so I can spend more time here. But at the same time, I'm taking a break, and I just checked into a hotel in Playa del Carmen because I really just want the toilet to flush for once. So in this week's video, I'm sharing with you the things I wish I knew about Tulum before traveling there. And trust me, I did my research about it and still got caught off guard by a lot of things. And my goal here is to share this with you so that you can plan a really great trip for yourself, because we all just want to travel, don't we? The first one is about money, and there are two things I knew in advance that I had planned for. The first is I knew that a lot of places in Tulum are cash only, which sucks, but I also knew that the ATMs can't keep up with the amount of cash that the tourists need, so they often run out of cash. And this was happening to me a lot while I was there. And so I planned in advance, and I have a video about that, but how I showed up with a large number of pesos that I was uncomfortable walking around with, but I needed it because a lot of places are cash only, and I wasn't able to get money out of the ATM 3 of the 4 times that I went. So I blew through that cash pretty quickly, but another thing to know that I didn't anticipate is how prices fluctuate. And this drove me bananas. And what I mean by this is prices fluctuate based off of whatever they want to charge you, which isn't terribly uncommon in other countries. So for example, taxis will try to get you to pay as much as they can. So if you're in Tulum town and going to the beach, a going price would be $8 to get from the town to the beach, which can be anywhere from a 10-minute ride to a 4-hour ride, depending on traffic. We'll get into that. Taxis will try to get you to pay double that if they think they can get it out of you. So that's expected, and you can do your little negotiation. But here's one that drove me crazy: the cenotes. The cenotes are beautiful, and you have to visit them. If you go to the cenote that's closest to Tulum town, if you check on Google and all the amazing reviews of it, the going price to get in is around $5. And when you go now, they just, you know, felt like charging $17 on that day. Cost-wise, this is a relatively expensive experience. It's $17 a person, and that's not the normal price. They are totally just charging whatever they want, and when you read the reviews, they'll just charge you if you have extra things like GoPros or stuff like that. So hiding your camera is key, but when I went and looked, there were just so many people, and I was like, I'm not gonna be doing this right now. If they see that you have a GoPro, they're gonna charge you even more. And so it's just kind of a bummer that the prices that you expect to pay might be wildly different than what they actually are. All right, that's it for money. Let's talk about the beach, because a lot of things I'm gonna unpack for you here. But if you're getting some value out of this, cheers that like button and consider subscribing and share this with somebody who might be traveling to Tulum. Tulum Beach, it's split between north and south, and it's a one-way road getting in and out. And that one-way road, if it's at all backed up, can take you an easy 10-minute taxi ride to get there. Or on one of the days that I was there, people were in traffic for over 4 hours to go about the equivalent of 3 miles. It's better if you just walk. But one thing to also know about that road is that they don't really take care of it. And so there's a lot of potholes, and if it's raining, then those potholes will fill with lots of agua and will splash all over you while you're walking or riding a bike. Let's pause for a second and talk about biking, because a lot of people ride bikes from town to beach, because who doesn't want to ride a beach cruiser to the beach? And there is a really great straight, flat, and pretty well-paved road from the town to the beach. So if you're getting directly to the north part of the beach, it's a really great option. But the main portion of the beach that most people, not all, want to go to is the south portion, which is not paved, is a one-way in and out road, and has tons of potholes. And so I want to share this story with you, not to scare you out of it, but so you can make the right decision for you. So riding a bike in Tulum town, there is somewhat of a bike lane. Getting to the beach, there is that one paved road, but once you're on the beach, it's kind of a free-for-all on that crazy, crazy road. I am an experienced cyclist that uses the hand signals. I used to race a road bicycle 100 miles all the time when I was living in San Francisco. So I find riding a bike in lots of places around the world to be very easy. Tulum is one of the moments that I was closest to death ever. And it was because a lot of the people who drive here don't really care about you. So if you choose to ride a bike, just do it with safety, be careful. And everywhere that I looked, it is impossible to get a helmet. So if that's something that matters to you, pack your own helmet. There's a crazy storm coming. There's a ton of traffic and I need to ride back to town, which should take around 30 minutes. And I'm nervous. In case you want to know what biking in Tulum is like. So on that amazing note, let's keep talking about the beach. Sorry, Mom, I know you're watching this, by the way. I'm okay. Okay, so getting to the beach, one thing to know is that use Google Maps with a grain of salt.
One of the things that drives me crazy about Tulum is that Google Maps is often wrong and will bring you to the wrong place. And it's really hard to find places.
Make sure you download the Google Maps in advance, link in the description below, because Wi-Fi and service, even if you have a Mexican SIM card like I do, service on the beach is basically non-existent. And also, speaking of non-existent, access to the beach. There's only a couple places that you can access the beach publicly. By the way, tell me in the comments below which of these tips has been most surprising to you, and tell me, when are you traveling to Tulum? I wanna know. All right, let's get back to it. As you ride your bike along the beach, I was expecting like, oh, beach on one side, jungle on the other, like seeing these amazing views. What you get to see is property after property and wall after wall. So actually accessing the beach is pretty difficult, and the public beach areas are pretty packed. So just get ready for that. The other way to access the beach, the way that I was doing it, the first way is to go to a beach club where you're paying a certain amount in food and drinks. Usually it's anywhere from $25 to $50 per person. It depends on where you're going, and that's super fun. Or the other way is just to charge through the property and walk straight to the beach, which I did a couple times too. And the other thing is, not all beaches created equal. So in other words, the north side of the beach that's closer to the ruins, there are some fun beach clubs there, but it tends to be the more mellow, the more quiet side of the beach. In the center, you kind of have a bunch of properties that are more like cliffs, so there's really no beach access. And then the south side is where it's party time, and you can find more of the active areas of the beach where you can have some fun in the beach clubs, etc., on the south side. So I know what you're gonna ask me next. It's around where to stay, right? Do I stay on the beach, the north side, the south side? Do I stay in town? There's so much I can say about this, and I'm creating a separate video all about it, but let me give you the Cliffs Notes version. The price difference between staying in the town and the beach is like 10x. It's significant, and it's a significantly different experience. Again, getting from town to beach can be relatively easy. It can also be impossible if there's traffic or if there's rain. So staying in town, you can get a lot more modern places, places that actually keep the air conditioning on. We'll get into that. And your money will basically go further in town versus on the beach. Here's one of the things that drove me bananas. I love doing my research online. I love to look things up. I love to read reviews. I like to look at websites. I love to do my research in advance and find properties online. The thing about Tulum is that the places that are available online that have a really great web presence that you can look at their Instagram feeds are the most expensive places on Tulum Beach. If you actually just simply go on a Google Maps and look at the number of properties, it's insane. There's so many hotels to stay at in Tulum on the beach, as well as in town, that you just will never find out about. And so in the 2 weeks so far that I've spent in Tulum, I stayed at 4 different properties. And one of the things I did was I got on my bike and literally just rode from property to property that looked interesting on Google Maps or on TripAdvisor or wherever. And I would just go up to the front desk and be like, hola, is it possible for me to see a room? And how much does it cost? And these are a couple things that I learned. One, there are way more properties than you could possibly imagine, like I said before, that are not listed anywhere, not even on Google Maps sometimes. The second thing, if you are there in person, paying in person, even if it's with your credit card, it costs significantly less. And the last thing I learned is that a lot of the places that looked so good in the pictures did not look like that in person. And I'm so glad I did not spend the $200 or $300 a night on those eco hotels that turn off the air conditioning at a certain time at night and leave leave you to the jungle heat. And speaking of the jungle, let's talk about that. I spent an entire week eating raw garlic before I traveled here because my mommy taught me that if you eat raw garlic, it will just seep from your pores, and it really did help with the bug situation. You can watch my Instagram reel about that disgusting thing. But one of the things that is guaranteed in life besides death and taxes is mosquitoes in Tulum. You will just get eaten alive, period. I came here with pure DEET, I came here with natural stuff, I came here with the garlic, I came here with a huge citronella candle, and there's just get ready for the bugs, all right? Embrace it. Another great thing that garlic is great at repelling is men. So if you're a solo female traveler like I am, who ain't trying to holla at your amigo, it's another great solution. But I digress. Let's talk about seaweed, or sargasso. In other words, one of the things that Tulum Beach has a problem with is the seaweed, and it's kind of like rolling the dice. Pray that when you go to Tulum Beach, if you're happening to go to beach and not town, is the seaweed problem. In other words, I was lucky because when I was here, I got beautiful beaches with no seaweed. But it's one thing that you might just want to look up real time, whether it's on Twitter or on Reddit or on Instagram stories, to see what people are saying about the seaweed so that you can plan in advance for what kind of a beach situation you're going to be walking into. These next few make me feel so thankful I'm in Playa right now and not in Tulum. The Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi in Tulum is ridiculously bad. And it's fascinating because so many people who do not need to return to the office for some time are trying to work remotely in Tulum. And the Wi-Fi there is terrible. So many restaurants, so many properties, so many places are trying to be pop-up co-working spaces, and the Wi-Fi speeds are that of dial-up internet in some places. It is just ridiculous how bad the Wi-Fi is. The next one is if you care about your health and you want to get your workout on in the gym. Gym prices there, whew, they're expensive. You can have a phenomenal meal with drinks for $15 at one of the nicer restaurants, or you can go work out at the gym for $25. And that's just the case for working out in Tulum. So I still did it. I loved going to yoga at Yoga Dicha. It was fantastic. A class there was $17, but it's just one thing to be aware of. And another thing to be aware of, once you're all hot and sweaty from the gym, don't expect to get great air conditioning. A lot of the places, especially on the beach, because a lot of properties run on generators, will only have air conditioning for certain times of the day. And it's the jungle. And if you've never traveled to the jungle before, let me tell you, it's hot.
And I say, let there be air conditioning, please.
And the other thing about it being in the jungle is that the pipes are not that great. So flushing the toilet in Playa is just amazing. And flushing the toilet in Tulum happens about 50% of the time. It works about 50% of the time. Oh, Tulum, oh, the things I wish I knew before I traveled there. But you know what? I still love it, which is why I'm going back there after my trip in Playa. And I hope you have a really great trip in Tulum. I'm here every week with new videos. If you found this helpful, cheers that like button, and I'll see you in the next one. Ciao.